and was only suitable for people aged 18 or over, will almost certainly have an adult theme, and might well contain sex or violence, which are quite graphic. It may also contain explicit language, including sexual swear words. Thanks for listening.
But here's what his revelation comes to him. He's kind of got all this stuff, like, touching, wiping, mourning of the animals.
Not wiping, whipping.
Yeah. Also, yeah, not torture. Also not touching.
I am dyslexic. I hope I'm not having, like, a stroke.
Do it live! Fuck it! Do it live!
And an atheist almost always become supporters of eugenics and abortion.
A swine is hungry for nuts.
Jesus hates them too.
Satan is real.
Being a Satanist is an open declaration of revolt against counterproductive received wisdom and mindless rogue tradition.
Decapitate her head off.
We're done.
You're done.
Obama!
Welcome to the Godless Revolution. I'm Dan.
Yeah.
And I'm Ryan.
And tonight we have a super special, incredibly wonderful, awesome, very exciting guest in the studio with us. Joining us all the way from New Jersey is Mr. David Silverman, president of American Atheists.
Yay. Hey, Dan. Thanks for having me on. And thanks for having me on, everybody.
And newly published author of a book that is getting really, really great reviews. I've read
rightfully so.
The middle of chapter 8 and have loved every bit of it. It's awesome. Like, I've been reading it on my tablet and just highlighting shit and making notes all through it and everything. I'm really, really enjoying it a whole lot.
Thank you. I'm glad. Thank you.
Yeah. I know it's getting a lot of really great reviews. This is episode 92, by the way.
Yeah. We're getting close to that magic number.
I'd like to say, hello to everybody in Guyana.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, they'll appreciate that, I'm sure.
Yeah, only 8 more episodes until our 100th.
We still don't know what we're doing.
Yeah, I have yet to decide what special something we will be doing for that. Other exciting news or changes. I've rejoined the board for Atheists of Utah and we'll be helping them out with a lot of things. There's a lot of things that need to be cleaned up and straightened out. So a lot of work ahead of us.
Daddy's home.
I saw your comment. But the other board members are awesome. Grant also has rejoined the board.
And that'll straighten things up quite a bit.
Yeah. And Felicia, Jenny, and Sarah are all fantastic, wonderful, really, really intelligent individuals that, you know, we had one board meeting and I was very impressed with them. They're smart and hardworking and yeah, I'm really excited. There's going to be
Rockstar board.
It's going to be some very exciting things coming up. Anyway, tell us a little bit about yourself, Mr. Silverman.
Well, I'm very happy to be here. Thanks for having me on the show.
I'm so excited to have you here.
I'm 6'2". I've lost about 20 pounds since my talk. I'm about 183 right now.
You're looking very thin.
I'm working out every couple of weeks.
So what is the planking time up to now?
Actually, I've fallen off the wagon. I was up to 6.5 minutes planking.
Wow.
And I fell off the wagon.
Yeah.
So I think probably now I'd be back in the 4-minute range.
Oh, wow.
But it's hard to plank. And it's hard to keep it going. It's hard to keep it going.
Definitely. Yeah.
I really do enjoy it because it gives me a measurable progress. Mm-hmm. You know, and I seem to have a very strong core. So it makes me feel strong when I do it. And, it's just painful. Yeah. And I don't like pain very much. So it's hard to get motivated for 6.5 minutes of pain. 6.5 minutes of pain. Yay.
Some people are into that, man. Worse. You know, in different strokes, I guess.
But, I'm the president of American Atheists. I've been president now for 6 years and, I've been an activist for 20 years. And, over the course of those 20 years, I've seen a really dramatic positive change in America. And, you know, one of the things I hear a lot about is people are very unhappy. You know, Ryan and I were talking about the prevalence of the Mormon church here in Salt Lake City. And I know it's hard, but it's a lot better than it was 20 years ago.
Oh, definitely.
And, you know, we've made a lot of progress. Mm-hmm. I remember, when I first became an activist, back in 96, we were trying to put together a convention in New Jersey and, we had to find a hotel that would allow us to come and pay retail for the convention. And when we did find a hotel, they had those front banners and those boards in the front of the hotels that tell you where all the things are.
Oh, yeah.
Happening.
Yeah.
I keep forgetting.
Little directory boards.
Yeah, directory board. Yeah. On the directory board, they only put AA. They wouldn't put American Atheists. And if you called the hotel, and remember, this is in New Jersey. Uh-huh. Okay. And if you called the hotel and asked them if the Atheist convention was there, they would say no.
Oh, what?
Right. And that was 20 years ago in New Jersey. And now, last year, we had our national convention in Memphis.
That was such a good time.
That was a good time, wasn't it?
Yeah,
that was a really great time. And before we got to Memphis, the city of Memphis flew me out and put me up in hotels and drove me around and showed me a very good time.
Wow.
Yeah. And when we picked the Peabody Hotel,
mm-hmm.
okay? And when we walked into the Peabody Hotel, they had Welcome American Atheists projected up on the side of the wall. And this is just for my tour.
Wow.
This is just for my tour. And they had our logo and everything. And I'm talking a big sign that everybody in the hotel could see, Welcome American Atheists, at the Peabody in Memphis.
In Tennessee.
Yeah. So we are still, we're still, there's a lot more work to go, but we're making tremendous progress. And I know this is not a political show, but we got a presidential candidate
mm-hmm.
with the term non-religious attached to him.
Mm-hmm.
That's a thing.
That's huge.
That's a thing. Yeah. Okay. He calls himself a non-religious Jew. And yes, of course he's an atheist, but that doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And yes, of course I would rather him use an atheist, but that's not the point.
Yep.
He's got non-religious attached to his name.
Yep.
And that's a first. And on the other side, we've got the front runner Republican who thinks the Bible is the greatest book ever written.
Right, yeah. Right, right.
But he couldn't name a single Bible verse.
Yeah. Oh, you know, it's all great.
Or he misquotes them.
He couldn't name Genesis 1. He couldn't name John 3:16.
Yeah.
So now, and what happened? Jerry Falwell Jr. endorsed him.
Yeah.
Isn't that amazing? Think about that. 20 years ago, if they had a non-religious candidate on one side and a Republican candidate on the other who couldn't name a Bible verse, the religious right would be freaking out.
Oh, yeah.
And now they're siding with him. Why are they doing that? Because they know they have no voice. They know they've lost their power. They're siding with power because they have no choice. If they had choice, if they had power, they would have sided with Cruz or Bush.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but not. They're siding with the people that they think they're going to win. Why? Because they have no power, and they know it. So we're making a tremendous amount of progress.
You know, that's a fucking excellent point.
Yeah.
They aren't throwing their power behind a candidate in order to make sure that they'll win. It's now flipped itself,
yeah.
right?
Yes.
Where they look at the candidate who's going to win and then try to align themselves with
right,
that candidate.
Right.
Yes.
Wow. I hadn't thought of that.
We are making substantial progress.
Yeah, I hadn't thought of that either.
Substantial progress, yeah.
Because I'm always shocked that they don't rush to Cruz because he's obviously the guy for the party.
But he's going to lose.
Yeah, well, yeah, we hope.
Yeah.
Well, even with
they don't want to back a loser. And back in George W. Bush's day, their backing could help them win.
Yeah.
Now that ain't the case anymore. Isn't that interesting?
Well, I noticed on the news that when they're talking about Bernie Sanders, they're not saying Bernie Sanders the first non-religious president. Oh, Bernie Sanders could possibly be the first Jewish president.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Right.
It's like, well, he already came out and said he's basically culturally Jew. He doesn't really practice the religion anymore. He called himself non-religious,
but you don't want to use that. Did I hear Jewy in
there? No, I think I said Judaism.
Oh, okay. I thought you said Jewyism. kind of an amalgamation of the terms.
I've used the term Jewy before.
But think about how this is happening. Now, I wish Bernie Sanders would win, but I don't think he will.
Uh-huh.
But look at what he's doing. He is really opening the door for non-religious people in a high office. And if he does win, I think the 528 website raises chances at about 20% to win the presidency.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have an atheist president.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We got a 20% chance this year of getting an atheist president. And that's not including president atheist Trump.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So we're making substantial progress, and we're witnessing the beginnings of the end of the religious right in this country.
And what would that statistic been 8 months ago for Bernie winning the presidency?
Well, far less.
Two. I mean,
Even if he doesn't win, he's really opening the door for the next non-religious people.
Yes.
For the next atheists.
Yep.
Maybe the next one will actually use the A word. Who knows?
Yeah.
And it may take another couple of elections, but this is a substantial progress that we're seeing a well-respected atheist candidate, non-religious mm-hmm. candidate, who is not being trashed for being non-religious.
Yeah.
Right.
In fact, like you said, Ryan, they're covering for him. They're calling him Jewish.
Yeah. Which I almost wish they would just say, hey, he's a non-religious candidate. But even for him, that's kind of sad to say, still a no-win situation for him. There's like, if he comes out and says, I'm an atheist, he's going to lose a ton of votes.
I know that. And
which is sad.
And it is sad, but it's also, I mean, yes, it's sad, and we want to live there. We want to say, call yourself an atheist, and we want to live there. But what we have to do is say, hey, he called himself non-religious.
It's a step.
And it's a huge step. It's a big, massive step.
Yep.
You know, and it's something that we really need to appreciate. We are making serious progress in this country.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, even 5 years ago, if you were to have a candidate who said that they were non-religious, that would be an instant and immediate disqualification.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Even just 5 years ago.
Yep.
I mean, 20 years ago, they would not have even been, they wouldn't even have had the opportunity to say they were non-religious. 5 years ago, they would have instantly disqualified themselves for doing so. And now it's a non-issue, and or people are trying to claim them as their own. And your point about, the religious groups throwing their weight behind who they think is going to win versus the flip side that it used to be, where they would, where the candidates would court them to get their influence and get them, get people to vote them. That's huge. I hadn't realized that or thought about that. That was an excellent
point. We have to appreciate the progress we're making.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Or else we'll never be happy.
Well, and I think a lot of that progress is due in large part to the types of things that you and American atheists are doing.
I think so. I like to think we're mm-hmm. playing a serious part. In fighting God, I put together some numbers. I like numbers a lot. I love, the right kind of numbers, quantitative, independently validated, you can trace them yourself numbers. And I have traced that there's a substantial change in people looking at atheism, people considering atheism, people calling themselves atheism, in direct response to American atheist activities mm-hmm. over the course of a 2-year period. And it's a really shocking thing that I did not expect to find, because, I'm a skeptic. And when you're a skeptic, you want to prove yourself wrong. Right. That's what you do as a skeptic. You prove yourself wrong. So
this is what I'm thinking. How can I prove it wrong?
Right.
Yeah.
So I had this idea to test on how many times people search the word atheist in Google. And I saw an increasing trend, a trend that dramatically increased at a specific period of time. And then I mapped that time to American atheist activity, and it matches almost perfectly. Mm-hmm. And then I said, well, maybe it's a tide rising all boats. Maybe all the terms are rising, but they're not. Even agnostic isn't rising. Humanist isn't rising, and only atheist is rising. And here's an interesting thing. If you look at the time that I did this work, that I did this research, when I first came out as president in September of 2010, we put the first billboard up in front of the Lincoln Tunnel. It said, mm-hmm. It's a myth. Mm-hmm. And it was in part of the Lincoln Tunnel, and it was on the air. It was on the national news in 9 different countries.
Which is pretty big.
At the same time, and this is such an important It didn't really click on me on how important this was at the time. But at the same time frame, a certain large humanist organization, I'm not going to trash anybody, a certain large humanist organization took out a national television ad. Mm. They spent about 10 times as much money as I did. And if you look at the number of times people search the word humanist over the times that people search the word atheist, humanist doesn't rise at all.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody looked at it. Atheist goes up. Because people know what it means.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's really one of my key points in fighting God, is that we have a problem in this country, and it's our own fault. It's our own fault because we are choosing to differentiate ourselves. We are choosing to separate ourselves. I'm not an atheist. I'm a humanist. Yeah. I'm not an atheist. I'm an agnostic. Mm. I'm a free thinker. I'm a rationalist. I'm a naturalist. All these are, I'll just say it, complete bullshit euphemisms that cowards use to not say the truth.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's what we're talking about here. So if you go up to a Methodist or a Presbyterian or even a Catholic and you ask them what religion they are, they'll say Christian.
Yes.
They merged themselves. They don't look – I'm not a Christian like that. I'm a Christian like this. They don't do that.
Yeah.
I am a Christian. So when you look at the pie chart of the polls in America, you see 70% Christian. right?
Yeah.
And then what do atheists do? I'm not an atheist. I'm an agnostic. I'm a secular human. So blah, 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 blah.
I'm a non-believer.
Yeah. I'm a secular nun. So the, if you look at the polls, it says we're 3% atheists. Three.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, it's like closer to 2.5%. But I crunched some numbers in Fighting God because I love numbers. Okay. I love numbers. And if you don't have an active belief in a God, you're an atheist.
Right.
If you don't have an active belief in a God because you don't know what the universe holds, you're an atheist.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have an active belief in a God because you're on the fence, you're an atheist. If you don't have a belief in a God and you absolutely positively hate the word atheist, tough shit, you're still an atheist.
Yeah.
So I took these numbers and I crunched them all together, the people, and I included all the people who are atheists by definition, but don't call themselves atheists. And I got a number of 27% of this country.
Wow.
27% of this country. 2.5% say they're atheists. That means 90% of the atheists in this country don't call ourselves atheists.
Yeah.
This is our fault. This is our problem. All the shit we're going through is our problem because we say bullshit lines like, I'm not an atheist. I'm a bleh. Doesn't matter. I'm a secular Jew. I'm a lapsed Catholic. I'm a cultural Christian. It's all crap. If you don't have an active belief in a God, and a God, by the way, it's a supernatural intelligence. A supernatural intelligence. If you think God is a metaphor for love or humanity, that's an atheist. Okay? You're an atheist.
Yeah.
I'm holding a bottle of Coke in my hand. If I name this Coke God, and I say, look, now I believe in God, I'm not a theist.
Right.
I'm an atheist. I've just renamed something and pretending that I'm a theist, but I'm not. I'm not a Christian if I believe in a God that is all humanity together. No, you're not. In order to be a Christian, you have to believe in a supernatural God and a supernatural son that died and rose and became God.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
You're not a Christian if you're not that thing. If you believe in all, if you don't believe in a supernatural intelligence, you're an atheist. And statistically speaking, 27% of this country is. Now, I know that's aggressive. I admit it. But I'm making a point, and I say it in Fighting God. I'm making a point. We're not 3% of the population. Okay? The whole concept that we're tiny is our fault. I can defend, and I can show numbers that we're much, much larger. Now, we may not be 27%. We may be much larger. We may be much larger, okay? Because that's only the people who
are out.
Yeah. I mean, half the Jews are atheists. So that's the number I used. 22% of Christians say God is a metaphor for the universe.
Yeah.
Those are atheists, okay? It's aggressive use of numbers, but it's still defensible. And I understand, but the point is that this is all our fault. This is our responsibility. And that's why it is my responsibility and it is my problem. It is my problem when you, an atheist, don't call yourself an atheist. It's my problem. It's my business.
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, think about stem cell research, right?
Oh, yeah.
Now, this is just a great example that I just pick out of the air. George W. Bush halted stem cell research for 8 years because God told him to.
Mm-hmm.
Because religion told him to. What would he have done if we were 27% of the polls? We would have a different country. We would have a different Republican Party. We would have a different world right now if people told the truth. If people didn't cower, didn't hide behind euphemisms. Mm-hmm.
And didn't think that they had to pander to the religious right.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
If we actually just told the truth, we would have a better country. And that's why when I go up to somebody and they say, oh, I'm not an atheist, I'm a non-theist. No, I get in their face for it. And they say, don't tell me what to call myself. Yes, I am going to tell you what to fucking call yourself because it affects me. It affects my child. It affects the entire country. When we atheists cower behind euphemisms, we make ourselves look smaller. We take our own power away and we give it to the theists.
Yeah.
We give the power of us to religion.
Yeah.
And then we complain.
Yeah. Yeah. Honestly, I don't think that 27% is ridiculous. I mean, you know, you're still not, it's not like you're inflating that to a point where you're limiting theists to only the bad bills. Bill Donahue, Bill Craig,
no.
Bill O'Reilly. You know, this is still a pretty wide range of theists.
And this is after I backed out the religious nuns. Okay. This is legitimate numbers. So now I understand it's aggressive, but, and it's aggressive because I'm going from one poll to another poll to another poll, and they're not consistent across polls, and they're not the same samples, but they're all statistically significant quantitative samples. Mm. Okay. So I'm extrapolating, but it's reasonable extrapolation. And what we've got, I back out all the theists. I use, you know, defensible numbers, and I come up with 27%. And that's not including the people who lie.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
not including the atheists who lie. That's not including the atheists who say, I believe in God and really don't.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, I honestly think that's a very believable number, just with 24% of them being like, I don't like the term atheist. That's an icky yeah. word.
And that's too bad.
No, well, because, that's why we gotta normalize the word and be like, oh, atheist isn't a bad term anymore.
It's not a bad term. It's a great term.
It is.
I mean, independent is not a negative term. Dependent is a negative term.
Yes.
Right? Atheism is not a bad term. Theism is the bad term. Mm-hmm. Atheism is the freedom of that term. It's the negation of a negative. It's a positive term.
Yeah, well, and anytime somebody says that they have a problem with using the term or identifying with the term atheist because, you know, it upsets too many people or whatever, it's like, okay, well, build a bridge, get over that shit, and then set it on fire behind you, because it doesn't matter if you don't like it. By you not identifying with it, you are promoting a religious narrative.
Yes.
You're not religious. You know you don't believe in God, and you are cowering and kowtowing to a religious narrative that you don't agree with, but you're doing it anyway.
And there's another side of that story, and I also go into this in Fighting God, because there's a negative connotation to the word atheist.
Mm-hmm.
And in Fighting God, I took again, two samples from two different parts of research. One said, how well are the terms understood? Okay. So one piece of research said, how well are the terms mm-hmm. understood? 87% of Americans essentially know what an atheist is.
Mm-hmm.
50% essentially know what an agnostic is, which is a bullshit, useless term that
nobody
should
know. Which is still
an atheist. Yeah.
Right. Of course, they're all atheists. Okay.
Yeah.
It's just a euphemism for atheism.
Right.
Secular. 30% know what it means. Freethinker and humanist. 10% of the country know what it means. Now, that's one thing. Now, I mapped across that graph the acceptability of those terms, the people who like those terms. Guess what? The more you understand that the term is atheistic, the less you like the term.
Mm-hmm.
It's an even line. So it's not about the term atheist being unpopular. It's about the fact that people understand the term.
Right.
And so when somebody says to me, I'm not an atheist, I'm a humanist. I mean, when somebody identifies themselves as a humanist, they're actually identifying themselves by something that's going to be understood 10% of the fucking time. That means 90% of the time they're going to be misunderstood. And what does that mean? Misunderstood means assumed to be the norm.
Yeah.
Right.
Which means theist.
Well, and it's misleading.
You know, it's absolutely
it's deliberately misleading somebody.
Yes.
You know, if the question is, what are your views on religion? And you tell somebody you're a humanist and they have no fucking idea what that is. You're being deliberately misleading to them. You're hiding behind
you are lying.
Who you are because you're afraid of whatever the repercussions may be.
You are lying.
Yeah. Yep.
And we have to call them out on it. And they say, oh, don't tell me what to say, how to call myself. Yes, it is our business. And that's exactly what I'm going to do. Because you are making the world worse for me. Mm-hmm. You are affecting me. It doesn't matter how you wear your hair or what shirts you wear or what anything like that, but how you identify yourself works against me, affects me, and it affects my child, and affects everybody in this country, and indeed everybody in the world to a certain extent. We are giving our power away, and we need to stop now.
So one of the things that you talked about in the book also, I'm sorry, did you have a question?
No, go ahead.
Sorry.
I haven't let anybody talk yet.
No, this is great.
It's all right.
That makes our job easy.
So, Dave, what do you think? Oh, well, let me talk. Chapter one.
Everyone needs to go buy the book to find out what he's talking about because it's fantastic.
Yeah, definitely go and get the book.
Get yourself caught up. Fighting God by David Silverman.
So one of the things that you discuss in the book is that, you know, people who are religious, they're not stupid.
Right.
They're victims.
Yes.
And I would say that I agree with that for the most part. But at what point do you stop providing people with that easy and convenient excuse to say that they're just being victims? I'm talking about people like the Bill Donahues of the world or the Rick Wiles or, you know, these people who at their age and in the age of the internet and with as many discussions as they have had with religion, at what point do you stop saying that they're just victims and they are purposely misleading people and are and are being willfully ignorant assholes.
Let me add one quick thing to it, just because okay. this was almost exactly my question for right here. In the book, yeah, you do kind of create a little bit of a what maybe could be considered a false dichotomy with that they're either victims or liars.
Correct.
But continuing within that thought process, I mean, are there sincere believers, or are you a little bit in danger of strawmanning with the fact that they're all that's just been pounded into them since birth, and that
no, there are sincere believers, and sincere believers are victims. Mm-hmm. Okay, all sincere believers are victims. They're victims of a lie. Okay, if I tell you a lie and you believe it, you're a victim of the lie. Okay, we're talking about a man in the sky. We're talking about something that is inconsistent with everything we know in the world to be true. That, by definition, is wrong. That, by definition, is false. If you believe something false, you are believing a lie, and you are a victim of that lie. Yes, there are sincere believers, and no, they're not stupid, but they are victims, all of them. And if they're not victims, if they're not believers, then they're what Dan was talking about. They're liars. Mm-hmm. These people who are, and I'm not going to mention any names because I don't go into people's heads.
Sure.
But, you know, if you say the Bible's the greatest book ever and you can't name a single Bible verse, I'm not naming names. Okay. But you're talking about a person who is lying. Okay. And that's an atheist. Okay, so you're a believer or you're an atheist. If you're a believer, you're a victim. If you're saying you're a believer and you're not believing, you're a liar.
Yeah.
And that's the way it works. And yeah, there is probably a gray area in there with self-delusion. And, you know, there's that, you know, I'm no psychologist. I'm making an activist statement here. Mm-hmm. But for the very, very most part, even the self-deluded, why are they self-deluded? They're self-deluded because they were taught to do that, because they were brainwashed to do that. Nobody who wasn't brainwashed to self-delude self-deludes.
Sure. Yeah.
Right? So they're victims anyways.
Well, and I think the biggest part of that is that they've been victimized to a point where they don't even want to question their beliefs because they're afraid of the consequences of losing that belief.
Yeah.
You know, even if it turns out that not believing is correct, they're still afraid of the potential consequences if it isn't correct, right? Like if they lose their faith and things are correct and then they're going to burn in hell forever, it's much more safe, I would guess, to a lot of these people to just set all of their doubts aside, right?
To not think about it.
You know, the Mormons always say, "We'll just set it on a shelf."
Right.
Set it on a shelf and you know, maybe come back and visit it later. That's the big Mormon.
But aren't they also victims?
Yeah.
Aren't those people also victims? So so the dichotomy holds.
I mean, they still use the same opening thing that they were whispered in their ear at the age of two on sitting up on the podiums, like, "I know my God is true because mom and dad love me."
And being fed the lines the whole time.
They'll be 30 years old going, "I know the church is true because my mom and dad love me."
Yeah.
Because my mom and dad taught me to recite this at a very early age.
Yeah. That's all I know.
Yeah.
Victims, victims, victims. Mm-hmm. Victims of a lie, victims of a scam, victims of a con, victims who need and deserve our help.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Before they perpetrate that same line of thinking and victimize other people.
Yeah, and we owe it to their children to help them.
Yeah.
We owe it to their children. This is us. This is humanism.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is humanism. This is caring about other people. This isn't about, I mean, think about this. If I say live and let live, just, okay, you do your thing and I'll do my thing. How am I helping people? How am I doing good here?
Yeah.
I'm not. Yeah. If my mother, and this is something that I mentioned in the book, my mother used to go to a psychic, right? And when I found out, I yelled at her. And I said, "What the hell are you doing?" We had a whole big argument. I stopped her from going to a psychic. That was a good deed.
Yeah.
That was a good deed. I did good by my mother. I protected my mother. She didn't know better. I taught her the ropes. I showed her the tricks and she learned and she didn't give money. So why is it different for religion? Religion's a bigger scam than a psychic. Religion takes more money than a psychic, more power than a psychic. But when it's your closely held religious beliefs, we're supposed to respect it.
Yeah, and fuck all of that. I don't understand why people think that we have to offer some special deference
because
to religion.
Because religion says so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because religion says so.
And
religion
then they buy
says
into
so
the,
for yeah. its own benefit.
Yeah, and then they buy into that narrative and promote it themselves when they tell you to just, you know, let people have their beliefs and you know, you do me or you do you do me and I'll do me and everybody will do me and it'll be a great time. But when it's just, when they have that live and let live and, you know, I'll do me, you do you kind of attitude.
It helps religion and nobody else.
It does. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have a product in the market. The product's harmful. You take it off the fucking market. People stop you from having that product in the market.
That's right.
But religion
and
has
a good thing.
It's a good thing. Like, hey, that's harmful. Let's not be selling this anymore.
Lawn darts, bad idea. Let's take them off the market.
But God, those were so fun. I love that shit, man.
But
I miss
since
that game.
We pander to politicians and the political party panders to the religious side of things, it's never going to happen until we get someone going in and going, hey, guess what? What you're doing is it's mental abuse to these people. You got to stop.
And here's a very important point, because and you raise a really important point when you're talking about telling people that, because religion won't tell people that. Okay. No. You're not going to get a Jew telling a Christian, hey, your God isn't real. Okay. That's not going to happen.
Yeah.
No, that's not, because then they're going to have a fight about whose God is real. They're both going to lose and they both know it. In other words, the only people who are going to say, hey, your religion is hurting you. Hey, your religion is bad, is us.
Yeah.
And that makes it on us to do it. That makes it our ethical responsibility to say that religion is bullshit. That makes it our job, because if we don't do it, nobody will. And the scam will persist. Mm-hmm. And those people's children will be infected by it. And so it's on us. We have a humanistic ethical responsibility to take religion down.
Well, and to backtrack just a little bit, earlier you mentioned, you know, that if you look at the statistics, you know, X number of people identify as Christian. And then, you know, as far as non-believers, it's the atheists, agnostics, brights, humanists, whatever. Right. Have you noticed, and maybe this is just me, but I've noticed that, you know, it seems like in days past, people would say, I'm a Catholic, mm-hmm. I'm a Presbyterian, I'm a Jehovah's Witness, right. I'm a Mormon.
Yeah.
And now, when I look at these things, it's, I'm a Christian.
Yeah.
I'm a Christian, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Jew, I'm a Hindu. They're lumping themselves all into a much broader, yeah. They're all snuggling and huddling under a much broader umbrella, right?
While we divide ourselves.
Right. To provide themselves more cover. Yeah. And we continue to divide ourselves. And yeah, it seems interesting to me that they used to always say, no, I'm a Presbyterian, I'm a Methodist, I'm a Catholic.
Yeah, that's
instead of just saying I'm a Christian.
That's a Jerry Falwell moral majority type of effect. They, you know, under Reagan, people started calling themselves Christians instead of separating themselves out, and it worked really well for them. It was a really good campaign. It got everybody calling themselves Christian, and it made Christianity look huge,
mm-hmm.
and it made us look tiny and insignificant.
Yeah.
Even Mormons have gotten on that bandwagon.
Yeah. Mormons are Christians too. Everybody's a Christian, but we're not a Christian. We're not atheists. We're agnostic, secular, humanist. It's all bullshit. It's us playing their game and helping them win.
Mm-hmm.
I have a pedantic point here.
Okay.
It's actually not for you. It's actually sort of in defense of you, but I thought it was funny. So, I did my own little editing. You'll have to bear with me while I read this. This is some of Dave's fan mail that was included in the book.
I know where you're going. Yeah, I get my share of fan mail.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. There'll be a question after, but it starts by saying, just wanted to let you know that you people are scum. No comma. You are bacteria that grows under a pile of shit. And David Silverman, no comma, not capitalized, that un-American piece of shit, faggot-loving, not capitalized, perspective switch, no comma, no hyphen, son of a rotten cunt, incomplete sentence, needs a comma, not a period, capital N needs to move to another country, no subject, no comma, he obviously has no love for America, not capitalized, and its values. Should be nor, not and. Yeah. I'm, no apostrophe, gonna, improper fraction, continue to tell you people, perspective switch, what parasitic garbage you are. Have a Merry Christmas, buncha, improper fraction, douchebags, incomplete sentence. Now, I did that for two reasons. One.
Because it's funny.
Yeah.
Yes. And I'm kind of a dick as well. So I like calling people out when they're unnecessarily hostile.
Yeah.
And two, theists are often accusing us of calling them stupid.
Right.
And attempt to counter that with statements like this that would embarrass a third grader with grammar. And not all theists.
Right.
But how do you deal with that kind of interaction? And why is it that theists think this is an appropriate exchange?
Well, or that it's helpful for their cause.
Well, the theists who write that are not the theists who are thinking things through. I mean, these are not educated people. These are victims of a very poor education system and a lot of brainwashing. They're injured. They're hurt. And you know, when more educated pastors see that kind of thing, normally I get apologies for it, and I don't care for apologies for other people. You can't apologize for another person.
No, sure.
But I mean, we get a lot of mail like that. We get a lot of hate mail with the misspellings and the capitals and the lie and the name calling. It is the beginnings of what I think is the effect that we're having. You know, religion is on the downturn, and people know it. People see it, people can sense it, and they're getting afraid. And so the preachers are complaining to the flock. Mm-hmm. The flock is reacting and sending us stuff like this. And, you know, every time I go on Fox News, every time I, you know, go on anything that will put me in front of an uneducated, brainwashed person, I get a lot of email like that and quite a few death threats as well. And it's discouraging, but it also reminds me that I'm here to do good. Mm-hmm. Okay. This person who wrote that note and everybody like him needs my help, and his children need my help. They need our help. They're being victimized by the shit that is religion, the lie of God, and combined with a very poor education system. So it is our responsibility to look at that with compassion. It's not hate and it's not stupidity. That person might not be stupid at all. He sounds stupid, but actually he sounds really, he sounds really ignorant, right? He
doesn't sound. Ignorance probably better.
And that's the word. And it's an important word. And it's up to us to realize that these people who are hostile, even as they are hostile to us, even the ones who are putting death threats into my box, even the ones who are scaring me, are victims of this shit. And we owe them pity, not anger, not hatred. We owe them pity. We owe them. I mean, you ever watch Star Trek? You know Star Trek, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, everybody saw Star Trek. So Star Trek, they have a Borg, right? Yep. So Borgs are collectives, right? You go down to a planet.
You will be assimilated.
Yeah, you will be assimilated. You find a person, you stick them with a tube, they become a Borg, and then they have to try and kill you. And you have to kill the Borg, or else they're going to kill you because they're Borg, and they don't stop. They never stop. Now, you're feeling bad for them when you do it, because they're innocent victims of being assimilated into the collective. And if you wanted to, if you could take them out of the collective. That's part of the narrative too in Star Trek. You can take a Borg out of the collective and make them people again. And that's great, and that's happy, and we would love to do that as humanists. We would love to go to these guys who are threatening me and help them out of religion. But until we do that, we have to fight them as we pity them with everything we got. Because they're trying to kill us, and they're trying to hurt us, and they're trying to assimilate us.
So in a sense, you have the Borg as an analogy for religion, and both of which are saying resistance is futile.
That's right.
Yeah. But we know better than that. And that's what a lot of what this book's about really is, that it's not futile.
No,
there is a way we can beat the Borg collective or the theocracy collective or whatever it is.
And actually we are beating them. We are winning.
Yeah.
We are winning. We are making serious progress. And you know, we're still in the middle of a big fat war, but we are making serious progress against this Borg. Against the Borg. Yeah.
Yeah, we absolutely are. I mean, you hear about the war on Christmas, which is just,
that one's
just total bullshit anyway. But I mean, they have to make it this dramatic, huge thing. You know, it's not people disagree with us on principle because we have, you know, a difference of opinion. It's they're warring on my religion and my privilege to do whatever the fuck I want, whenever I want, because I'm a Christian.
And it's not just about their ability to do whatever the hell they want. It's about their ability to do whatever they want, but you can't do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's about privilege. It's about they can do something you can't. They talk a lot about equality, but they don't want it at all. That's why there's such a big constraint. Oh, you said season's greetings or happy holidays instead of Merry Christmas.
You rotten bastard.
That doesn't hurt Merry Christmas at all, but it's an attack. They consider it attack because it puts them equal with everybody else. And when you call a Christmas tree a solstice tree or a holiday tree, oh, it's an attack on Christianity. No, it's an attack on the privilege that Christianity had over everybody else, a privilege that it doesn't deserve and doesn't get according to this country. Whether you're a Christian or a Jew or a Muslim or an atheist or a pagan or a Satanist, you have exactly the same rights in this country. They don't like that. Christians don't like that. So they want to be up. They want to be above. I remember Sean Hannity once saying to me on his show, Christians aren't equal to pagans. But you are. But you are. And you might not like that you are, but you are only equal to everyone else. And these are the equalophobes that I talk about in Fighting God. These people who are afraid of only being equal to everyone else. That's what the entire war on Christmas is. It's not a war on Christmas. It's a war on Christian privilege over other religious beliefs.
Yeah. And well, then being afraid to lose that
privilege. Yes.
Yeah. I love what I think it was Matt Dillahunty that I first heard this from, but he was talking about that whole thing about Merry Christmas versus Happy Holidays. And just the amount of assumption that goes into telling somebody else Merry Christmas. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like walking around on your own birthday and telling everybody else Happy Birthday.
Exactly.
Because you expect that they, you know, come on. How do you know that this person is going to be celebrating Christmas? It's silly.
It is silly. It is silly. And when you look at it, and this is why Fox News won't have me on anymore, because I keep drilling this point into them, that when you look at it, this isn't about a war on Christmas. It's a war about equality. Yeah. It's a war about having the same rights as everybody else. It's a war about Christians wanting to be more equal than you.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's it.
Yeah. I was going to say, just last year here in Utah, there was a state bill that came out where they were trying to pass an anti-discrimination bill for the LGBTQ community. Well, the Mormon Church had to get involved with it, and they had to add a Religious Freedoms Act onto the bill.
So the bill
became the Anti-Discrimination and Religious Freedom Bill, which basically allowed the church to discriminate against any gay person they wanted to.
And this is a very important point, because religion is all individual.
Yeah.
Everybody, and if there are any believers out there, and every believer on the planet falls into this category, they all agree with their God. Okay? They all agree with their God. Nobody in the world says, well, God thinks this, but I disagree.
Right.
Okay? Nobody. They all agree with their God. So that means all gods are individual. All religion is individual. To the nth degree, all religion is individual. Mm-hmm. So if you have a religious freedom bill, okay, if you have a religious exemption bill, what that means is you're allowing me to invent a God, which is what all believers do, and use that as an excuse to break the law. I invent a God that says I get to drive 90 in a 55 zone. It's my religious freedom if you stop me. I believe in a God that says I get to shoot people. I get to kill people. I get to rob a bank. I get to do whatever I want. My God says so. It's my closely held religious belief. It is exactly the same thing. We have civil laws for a reason. Mm-hmm. We have anti-discrimination laws for a reason. And you may like those laws or not like those laws. And yes, I know that some people think that there should be no discrimination laws and some people think there should be lots of discrimination laws. My point is, those laws exist. And the fact that you think you have a God that doesn't like it doesn't allow you to skip any law. It doesn't allow you to break any law. My God wants me to break the law does not exempt you from that law. Mm-hmm. And that's why religious exemption bills like that are wholly illegal. And they're complete bullshit, because they allow people to just say, I'm going to break the law because my God wants me to.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned in the book, there was on page 116. Hopefully you'll remember. No.
Because you've memorized the page.
Yeah,
absolutely.
It is your book after all.
Statements though, like religion has no positive value.
Yes.
Do you worry that will distract from other significant parts of the book, such as fighting RFRA, the failure of oversight for religious nonprofits?
Absolutely not. Religion has no positive value. And we have to take that point on. Everybody says, oh, religion makes me feel good. Religion gives me community. Religion gives you community because you were born into that religion. And religion has told you that it makes you feel good. And religion has told you that you need the community. Religion has told you all about all of its positive effects. But here we are, four non-religious people, four atheists, and we're fine.
Yeah.
So nobody needs
better
religion.
Off.
We're better off. Nobody needs religion. Yeah. So if nobody needs religion and religion is a lie, what exactly are the positive effects?
What kind of community could you have outside of religion? I mean, your religion has taught you that your community are these people. You have no idea how much greater it could be outside of that. How much better it would be if it were more diverse, if you had a wider range of opinions and experience from other people that you could then experience through their stories and getting to know them and broaden your horizons. You're putting yourself in a tiny little box and limiting your own experiences in life based on what this particular tribe that you happen to be born into tells you to do.
Exactly. I mean, people tell me religion has a positive value. I ask them what exactly it is. I mean, it makes me feel good. Well, so does heroin.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, it doesn't mean it's a positive value. Religion is completely 100% useless in today's society. Religion is completely fallacious and completely malevolent.
Yeah.
It's a lie. It's a scam. It's a con, and it deserves to die.
I've asked people several different times whenever I get in discussions with them, and they say, well, religion is a net positive for a lot of people, and it makes a lot of people feel comfortable. It makes a lot of people feel good. You know, what would the world be like without religion? Okay. And I'll ask them, okay, well, give me even one thing, just one. I'll give you all the time in the world that you need. Tell me one thing that religion adds as a positive that you cannot find outside of religion.
Right.
Just one. That's all I want. I'm not asking for a list of 10 or 3 or anything. Give me one and you can take all the time you want.
Yep.
And nobody has ever been able to give me an answer.
That's because it's all crap.
Yeah. Or a religion valid
tells
answer.
People think they need religion because religion tells them they need religion.
Yeah.
Okay. People think religion is important because religion tells them it's important and makes them think it. It's part of the lie. It's part of the scam. It's like if I bought a used car for $1 million that was worth $5, and I kept, and the salesman was on me saying, oh, it's a great car. It's a great car. It's a great car. You need this car because if you get inside it, it'll keep you the rain off of you. Okay. It won't run, but it keeps the rain off of you, and you need to get the rain off you. So you better thank me for this $1 million used car. Right. It's complete crap. Everything you can get from religion that's positive, you can get elsewhere. Mm-hmm, and everything else that you can get from religion is a lie and a scam and a con. And that's why religion is all negative. All of it is negative. Now, I want to make sure I define my points. When I talk about religion, I am not talking about non-religious churches, and I'm not talking about those Unitarian-ish and some Unitarian churches that are non-religious. Religion is a theistic religion. I'm talking about the practice of a belief in a God, which is defined as an invisible, I should say, supernatural intelligence. Mm. Okay? That's the lie. I have no qualms at all with any sort of a church-like entity that doesn't tell a lie, mm-hmm. that doesn't talk about a God or a man in the sky. I contend they're not churches. I contend those are not religions. I look at my friends at the Council for Secular Judaism. They're not a religious organization. They call themselves one. They call themselves religious. They file tax exemptions. They're atheists. They're not religious. They're a club. They're not religious. I don't have a problem with them. I have a problem with them calling themselves a religion because it makes religion look bigger and atheism look smaller.
Yes.
And you have a problem with them calling themselves Jews.
Yes, I do. Because it makes Judaism bigger and atheism smaller.
Yeah.
But I don't have a problem with them ethically existing. I don't call them a net negative and a scam and a con because they're not lying. Okay. They're not spreading the lie of God.
Right.
They're not talking about something that is provably false. They're as provably false as unicorns and leprechauns. Mm-hmm. They're not talking about that. So when I say religion is 100% scam, 100% con, religion deserves to die, I'm talking about real religion. Religion as defined as the belief and practice of a belief in a God, which is a supernatural intelligence.
Well, and going to the view of, you know, atheistic Jews not being Jews. One of my favorite talks that you ever gave was to a secular Jewish group, I think in Arizona.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a thing.
Yeah, that was.
You know, I've given a lot of speeches, but that one stands out.
I really, really liked that a whole lot. I mean, it was just, you know, you gave your speech and you were interrupted a couple different times, but at the end of the Q&A session, it was just question after question after question of, you know, well, yes, I am a Jew, and here's why. And you shot them down just in succession.
Yeah.
And nobody seemed like everybody was pissed off.
Right? And everybody, you know, it's
but
it's
they couldn't give you a reason why they were pissed off.
No,
really.
Because they're wrong.
Yeah.
That's the thing. It's the thing about being right. You know, you can take all the questions that you want, you know. But we're talking about a large congregation of the secular Jews, okay? Large, quote, congregation of secular Jews who are atheists. And I stood up in front of them all and I told them that none of them were Jews. Yeah. You are not Jews.
Yeah.
And that's a thing because I was raised Jewish.
Sure.
And so you've got the whole, I mean, I'm a victim of the brainwashing too. I was there. I was the whole brainwashing doesn't just end at the lie of God. Brainwashing continues into, oh, Jews are a people.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
we're special. Mm-hmm. We're a tribe. We're a race. Mm-hmm. You know, we have more Nobel Prize winners than everybody else. You know?
Well, that is true.
No, it's not.
Is it not?
It's not. Ashkenazim, the people from Eastern Europe. Yes.
Oh, okay.
Ashkenazic Jews, people who look like me, people who look like me and Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah.
We come from a section of the world, like a country, and we do have a large connection, a large thing. But that's not Jewish. If you look at the Sephardim, if you look at the Ethiopian Jews.
Yeah, so I did the very same thing
exactly,
you're talking about. Yeah.
Exactly. So, yeah. So Judaism takes the credit for everything else. Now, think about this. Is falafel Muslim food? Is chicken chow mein Buddhist food? Why in the world is Jewish food Jewish if it's all coming from Eastern Europe? Oh, and by the way, the Sephardim and the Ethiopian wouldn't know a bagel, lox, and cream cheese if it bit them on the ass.
Right?
It's not Jewish food, but Judaism takes the credit.
That's amazing.
So, it was, you know, this is something that I realized in Fighting God, because the interesting story, and this is a part of the book, because I set out in Fighting God to prove Jewish atheism as valid. I set out to show it's true, and I failed. This is skepticism.
Right.
I completely failed. Every single time I looked at Jewish anything, I realized it wasn't Jewish at all. It was just Judaism taking the credit for something that's local, something that's location dependent. Everything else is location dependent. I am an Italian. I'm Irish. I'm German. It's location dependent. This is Middle Eastern food. This is Chinese food. This is Japanese food. It's location dependent. Only one place, only with Judaism, is food Jewish, is dance Jewish. Okay, that's not a thing. You can look Jewish.
I'm gonna have to stop
you
right there.
You can look Jewish.
I know that here in Utah there is Mormon food. Like I cannot imagine in any other culture anywhere else that someone could look at a dish of green jello with shaved carrots in it and not know that that is a Mormon dish. Right? That's the one.
It's a disgusting dish.
It is. That's
a thing. Green jello with shaved carrots is the thing.
Don't
forget funeral potatoes.
Oh, and funeral potatoes.
And funeral
of course.
But I mean, apart from funeral potatoes, I've seen in other religions or cultures or whatever.
Yeah.
Green jello with carrot shavings, I have not seen anywhere else outside of Mormondom.
Well, that's a thing.
So that's, you know,
maybe that's the exception to my rule.
When people are like, "I'm culturally Mormon," I'm like, "What do you mean you're culturally Mormon?" Like, blah, blah, blah.
I like jello with carrots.
I like lime jello with carrots.
So that's Mormon food. So lime jello with carrots is Mormon food. But what does that do? It makes people say they're Mormons long after they're Mormons.
Yeah.
So it makes people say, and think about the Jews. I'm Jewish. I'm a Jewish atheist. Bernie Sanders. Non-religious Jew.
Sure.
It makes them claim Judaism when they're not. And statistically speaking, 52% of people who call themselves Jews in America are atheists.
Mm.
Think about that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's half the Jewish population is lying, or at least wrong.
Yeah.
Okay? And they're misled. They're victims of the lie that they're Jews when they're not. In fact, the entire cultural Judaism campaign, the entire cultural Judaism wing is wrong.
Well,
all
of it. It's arrogant too, right? To say that you are a cultural Jew. You by what you do and the things you identify with, you are culturally a Jew. Everybody else who doesn't do that is not.
Well, it's in group and out group.
Yeah.
It's in group and out group. Some people are arrogant about it. Some people, and you know, when they get into the whole Nobel Prize thing, they get real arrogant. And it's really discouraging to see that kind of stuff. But some people are just brainwashed into thinking about it. I know that I had a period of my life when I was arrogant about it.
Yeah.
Because I thought I was a part of a race. I thought I was a part of a race that, you know, had more Nobel Prize winners. We were smarter. We're just smarter. That's what I was taught, you know, and it was all because of Judaism.
Yeah.
So I was proud to call myself a Jewish atheist. But guess what? It was complete crap.
We'll take the smaller penises for the Nobel Prizes. Yeah, that's us right here. No, that's a stereotype, too. I don't know that that's true.
That's a completely false stereotype.
I don't know that that's true. I just I'm Irish. What am I saying? We have the same problem.
We don't have a problem.
No, but interestingly, though, my father, who's a theist, But I continually talk to him about these kinds of things. Mentioned you were going to be on the show, hoping maybe he'd know. He's 70. Maybe he'd know Madeline or something like that. But he was unfamiliar. And I said, yeah, well, his name's David Silverman. Oh, guy sounds like a Jew.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, yeah. Actually not. But the same thing. It's the same thing.
It is.
Just from the name. Never heard of you. Nothing.
Well, my parents were originally going to name me Jew, but they decided it wasn't Jewish sounding enough. So they called me David Silverman instead.
What? Yeah.
I actually had a friend named Jew.
Yeah. Really?
J-U, he was Korean.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah. I think David Silverman covers it.
Yeah. And of course, it's not a Jewish name. It's an Eastern European name. They came through Ellis Island. They all came through at once. They had those Jewish sounding names, but they had those common names. And so, that's what they did. Yeah. And it's not Jewish, but Jewish sounding because we're associating that with that because of Ellis Island.
Well, my first two names are Matthew David.
Yeah.
I mean, that's Hebrew as well. Yeah. But I have not an ounce of it, I don't think.
Well, Matthew's not Jewish, is it?
It's Hebrew, I think, isn't it?
I thought Matthew was more of a Christian name. Maybe it is.
I don't know. Whatever.
David
I don't give a shit.
David means beloved gift of God.
Yes, it does.
Yes.
Yep.
So I'm a gift of God.
Yeah.
Thank you, God. You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Yeah, which one?
I think you might have made a mistake there.
You've read. Yeah. This one I think you will remember from the book.
Okay.
So what's a dick part?
Okay.
And I couldn't take a pass on the skull fucking your savior.
Yes, I had to delve a little bit into the vulgarity. This is after a lot of the vulgarity was taken out of the book. What you see is the cleaner version. You know why people from New Jersey swear so much? Because fuck you. People call me a dick so often, because I tell the truth. And if you compare me to people who are actual dicks, who will say things like yesterday when I was skull fucking your savior, that's a dick thing to say. You know, that's something that you say to piss people off just to make things angry. I don't do that. Okay. It says in the book, I actually don't say things like yesterday when I was skull fucking your savior. That's the quote that you're talking about.
Yes. Yes.
So it actually says I don't say that.
Right.
And it's important that we realize that we get called dicks because we insult religion, because we take religion on, not because we're actually dicks. We're actually being polite. We're actually being caring. We're actually being loving. We're actually being good people when we try to take religion down. And we have to own that. And we have to, when people call us dicks, when they insult us, we have to own the fact that they are the victims who are calling us dicks because they're victims. And they've been told that anybody who insults their religion is a bad person. Anybody outside of their religion, that out group, is a bad person. Mm-hmm. So when we're talking about being insulted, we have to take that into consideration, and we have to realize that being called a dick, being called names, because we're simply telling the truth as caring humans, should not stop us from telling the truth as caring humans. They'll use insults, but that doesn't stop us. It shouldn't stop us.
No, yeah. we shouldn't cave into that just because, I've gotten offended and you've hurt my feelings.
Right.
Well, so.
Right.
Well, from all the numbers that you had in the book, being that a more offensive, in-your-face, militant-style atheist seems to be the only way to really get the message across.
It works.
It works. And I know you kind of, like, it's kind of like, you know, the militant atheist breaks the rock, then the other ones come by and polish it all up, make it nice little, okay, we'll smooth it over,
exactly.
Make it a little nicer.
And I will take issue with the word militant. I hate the word militant.
Okay.
I'm not militant, okay? I'm a firebrand.
Oh, yeah.
A militant person will, like, cause destruction, cause vandalism, cause harm. We don't do any, I don't do any of that, okay? I don't like the word militant.
Yeah.
But if you look at history, if you look at the civil rights movement, the gay rights movement, the women's lib movement, there were always firebrands and diplomats.
Yeah.
There was always a Malcolm X for a Martin Luther King. There were always the brow burners for the National Organization for Women. There were always the assless chaps for an ACT UP for the Lesbian and Gay Alliance.
Mm-hmm.
These folks work together. These movements work together. And they work. It functions. It's a consistent function. Malcolm X is a quote in my book. Malcolm X said something about, you know, I come in here to make Martin Luther King look good. Mm-hmm. And it's absolutely right. If it wasn't for Malcolm X, Martin Luther King would have been the bad guy. He would have been the hardest. He would have been the militant.
Yeah.
Okay? But Malcolm X took that off of him. And firebrands do that. They pave the way, and then they allow the good guys, the nice guys, to come in and, yeah, polish up the stones. Yeah. And it works. It's worked over and over again. And that's why I get so frustrated when people on the nice guy, so-called nice guy side of the movement, and I don't contend that they're nice guys all the time, but the people on the nice guy side of the movement yell at us.
Yeah.
And say, we shouldn't do this. We're dicks. We're being dicks. We shouldn't do this. They're just completely short-sighted. They don't even understand what the hell they're talking about. This is how progress is being made. The numbers that I have in Fighting God show a direct correlation. I want to make it clear. Show an apparent direct correlation between American atheist-specific activity after I took charge and a change in people calling themselves atheists, mm-hmm. and a change in people looking at atheists, and a change in people willing to vote for an atheist. It's an apparent direct correlation. This is not happening on the humanist side. This is not happening on the brights or anywhere else. This is happening only at atheism and only with American atheist-specific activity. I can show the numbers, and nobody else can. Nobody else can.
I know you mentioned the book, like every time you put a billboard up, those spikes you get, it's like, that's because it's that in-your-face message, and I love them. And I'm like, I think the messages are awesome, and it does get in their face, and it maybe makes them think, and that's why they don't like it.
That's right. They don't like it. They don't want to think, and they, you know, they take offense.
Yeah.
And so the... And they take offense because religion tells them to take offense. And then the so-called nice guy atheists get bad because we're offending people. But that's too bad. It's too bad that people are getting offended because they've been brainwashed into getting offended when we criticize religion. Yeah. We're going to criticize religion anyways. And people will get offended because they've been told to get offended. And the nice guy atheists can go sit on their hands and wait for us to pave the way. And they can come and clean up and say that they did something.
Yeah, well, and to paraphrase one of my favorite local firebrand atheists here, Dr. Clark.
Yes.
You know, it's the firebrands who are pushing for change. They're the ones pushing the sled. They're the ones pushing the wagon, pulling it in a particular direction. And then the diplomats can come in and grease the skids or the hubs of the wheels. You know, yeah. they're the ones that make it, they're the ones who make it a little bit easier and a little less of a burden for the firebrands to continue doing the work that they're doing.
And the super secret is the nice guy atheists are going to win. That's the plan, right?
You're right.
The plan is for them to win. The plan is for us to pave the way and them to come in from behind and say, oh, that David Silverman, he's so aggressive. We're not like him. We're nice guy atheists. And then what happens? They're nice guy atheists.
Yeah.
Right? And so we take our place at the table and the nice guy atheists bloom and everybody is happy. And that's the plan. That's how it happens. That's why, that's why there are more Martin Luther King boulevards than Malcolm X boulevards. That's what happens. Yeah. That's how it works. That's how progress gets made. That is the big plan.
Yeah.
I was actually pleased to see that part of your book. We have a whole episode called Disney Atheism.
Yeah.
Which is a term we use on the show regularly for that, the nice guy atheists, the ones that don't want to ruffle any feathers, that don't want to use the bad words. And so seeing that in your book, I was happy to see that because we feel the same way. I mean, but ultimately,
well, let's prove it out. Well, let's take a quick little break here. And when we get back, we'll have more with Mr. David Silverman.
Rock and roll.
Please stand by. The Godless Revolution will continue in a moment.
Hey, everybody, this is X.
And I'm Kyle.
And I'm Felicia. We're the Utah Outcasts.
Three out, unashamed, and active atheists living in Utah.
And we are personally inviting you to let us love your ears each and every week.
As we take the news, current events, and pop culture and give it a little twist.
A love twist, with consent.
And we'll be joined each week by a special guest to tell us what makes them an outcast like us.
Come find us.
The Utah Outcasts.
On podhell.com, Stitcher, iTunes, Google Play,
Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube.
And on UtahOutcast.com.
We finally bought that domain off the kids handing out mixtapes in the mall.
Come be an outcast with us.
Take care of yourselves out there.
Bonne nuit.
And you're welcome.
Rejoining the Godless Revolution podcast now.
Well, the two. I mean,
it's almost like it almost looks like their religion might have hurt Hillary, huh?
Oh,
all that God talk might have hurt Hillary in the least religious state. Gee, that's a thing, isn't it? Maybe religion was a bad idea.
I don't even think I ever heard O'Malley talk God at all.
Well, just all the pandering she's been doing there has been bothersome.
O'Malley, I don't.
Yeah, Hillary's always saying my God-given rights and all
that.
I like
O'Malley. He seems like a pretty good guy. I just think it's not. Yeah. It's not the right climate for him right now.
Yeah. Anyway.
Welcome back to the Godless Revolution. We're still in studio with Mr. David Silverman. I'm so fucking excited about having you here, man.
Hey, President, if you would.
President.
That's Mr. President. Yeah.
Mr. President.
Mr. President Dave.
Yes. David.
Mr. President Atheist Pants.
Which, by the way, I think was my favorite part of the book.
What's that?
When the priest demanded titles in the debate.
Oh, yeah.
And you said, all right, sure.
I'm president.
I just love the spite.
You know, and that goes back to religious privilege. The story is that I was in Fox News with somebody doing a debate, and I'm a first name person. Okay. Mm-hmm, I'm just a first name person. So I was calling him by his first name, which was Jerry. And, off camera, he was really not happy with that, and he suggested that I call him Father. Now, this is just recently after my father died, right?
Oh, wow.
So I'm not doing that. I actually got a little sad. I said, you are not my father. I'm not calling you father. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, I'm a spiritual father. I said, you are no kind of father to me. He said, well, use my professional title then. I said, what's that? He says, Reverend. I said, okay, I will use your professional title. My professional title is president. And he got really angry. He just walked away. And that's the thing. You know, he doesn't want to be equal. They don't want to be equal. They say, I mean, if you're a PhD, if you have a doctorate, I will call you doctor
because
you've earned it, right? Yeah. But if you want me to call you by a professional title, and you're going to call me by my professional title, it's not going to be Reverend and Mr. I can call you Mr. and you can call me Mr. I can call you first name and you can call me first name. I can call you Reverend. You can call me President, and you can never be called Father by me. My father called preachers whores.
Oh.
Okay. And that's not happening. Nobody gets called Father in my book except my dad, and he's dead.
Yeah, it's a little bit of that privilege thing. They need, like you're saying, they want to be put up there. They want everyone else.
Yes. They want the pedestal. They want the up.
Mm-hmm. They want to be more equal than everybody.
They want to be more equal than everyone else, and I don't give it to them. There's no way I would give it to them, because that just puts them up. It gives them an innate advantage. It gives them an innate advantage. If I go up against somebody with an actual doctorate, he gets an advantage. Doctor versus me. Doctor versus Mister. He's earned that advantage by earning the doctorate. But if you just have a profession, I've been working in atheism for 20 years.
Oh, sure.
I've earned my professional title.
Yeah, of course.
I earned it. And so you can call me President Silverman, and I'll call you Reverend, whatever the fuck you want.
And, you know, the Mr. never hurt Hitchens either.
No. No, it didn't.
So, yeah. But that I love that bit of the book. Buy it. Fighting God.
It's a good book.
It's a great book.
Did I mention that it's 75% five-star reviews right now on Amazon?
Yeah.
75% five-star reviews. I'm real happy with that.
It's a fantastic book.
I've been bothering Tracy the nights, well, up until this last week when I've been reading it in bed. I've been bothering Tracy because I'll read a section of it and I'll laugh.
Yeah.
And she's like, what are you laughing at? And I'm like, nothing, never mind. It would take too long to explain it. Just, I'm reading a book. You're going to have to read it yourself. Well, no, tell me. No, I'm still going to read the rest of it, man. Leave me alone. But yeah, she's just laying in bed, reading it on my tablet and giggling at different spots. That part about the honorifics during the debate, that was really funny.
Yeah. My wife even giggled at some of that. And she's a deist, but, you know, might as well be an atheist. But yeah, she enjoyed a bit of it too. So everyone needs to go get the damn book. You'll know what we're talking about.
I think you should. I think that's really good advice.
So there was a bit that stuck out to me, I think probably more specifically because of living here in Utah, but there was a part you said doubts are often begun and fostered by other people, and the church does not want you to doubt.
Right.
And around here, there's an oft-quoted phrase from one of the LDS, I guess he's in the presidency, Uchtdorf, yeah?
Yeah.
I never know how to pronounce his name.
Was in the Quorum of the Twelve, yeah.
No, I think he's in the first
Is he one of the top
three? He's the second counselor. Okay. Yeah. Anyway, doesn't matter. But
he's one of their woo-woo mucky mucks.
Yeah. He has a quote that floats around. Everyone loves it, and it's doubt your doubt before you doubt your faith.
Oh, isn't that nice? Right. Doubt your doubt before
How
you
convenient.
Doubt your faith. Isn't
right.
that great? That yeah. that sounds so skeptical.
Yeah.
That sounds so skeptical. Just assume that if you think I'm wrong, just assume you're wrong without doubting me first.
Yeah.
That's great. I'll bet that came from a religious leader.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
He's, wow.
He's third in charge of the Mormon church.
Wow. Isn't that interesting? And the Mormon church is so rife with doubt. I mean, there's so much to doubt.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, oh, yeah. there's just so much.
Third in charge in the Mormon church just means third richest.
Yeah.
I giggle, well, sure. I giggle when my LDS friends make fun of, like, Scientologists or the Raelians
or
anybody like that. And I'm like, you know, you have a lot more in common with them than you do more mainstream, mainline Protestant
I don't know,
Reformation.
Man. Are you Christian sure religions? About that?
Scientology came from the Thetans from the volcanoes.
Right.
And Mormonism, you come from
talking about
the planet Kolob and
space
our space babies.
And, yeah.
Yeah, but
it all makes sense to me.
Yeah, I mean,
you know, the God who needs to who creates man that's flawed and then blames him for being flawed.
Yes.
So then he sends his son down
yes,
to die,
exactly.
to be sacrificed, so that he can die, so that he can come back to life, so that he can rise up back to heaven, so that he can forgive man for being what he created.
Well, yeah, and
don't forget,
I think that's just as crazy as what you're talking about.
Well, but when we talk,
they add Mormons space into it.
Yeah, the Mormons have just as much in common. You know, they're just as crazy as Scientology and all that. Well, I mean, when you look
at
it in
injured,
terms of,
not crazy.
Yeah. When you look at
Fair
it in
enough.
Terms of, you know, taking the original set of scripture, the Old Testament and New Testament, whatever, and then adding an extra layer of bullshit onto it, and then talking about space wackiness that, you know, God was originally a man, as man is now, God once was, and as God is now, man may become.
Yeah,
he lives on another planet and or star near or on Kolob.
I hear what you're saying.
Traveled here to have sex with a virgin against her will.
Yeah, yeah,
that's
no,
that's fucking nuts.
I hear what you're saying, but I mean, at the same time, the split that you're talking about happened early 1800s from Methodism, right?
So, well, and in terms of age, so adding other layers of bullshit. And in terms of age, they're very much more in line with Scientology than they are, you know, traditional, quote unquote, Christianity.
Well, what are we talking about? Are we talking about
Mormons and Scientology?
They're more similar. Or are we talking about level of crazy? Because that's what you started with.
Well, more in line, and I would say level of crazy. I mean,
I know you
with some of the beliefs and things that the LDS. Elders and leaders have said in the past, like fucking Brigham Young saying that people lived on the sun
and on
the moon. I mean, just bullshit, wacky things.
I know you take the core biblical stuff and add stuff to it for Mormonism, right?
Add extra layers
of
bullshit,
at the same time, what I was just going to say, we're talking about early 1800s split from Methodism to Mormonism, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Catholicism has added extra shit or have kept extra crazy shit that the Mormons didn't take, like the fact that transubstantiation.
Yeah.
For example, I mean, the DNA, obviously, I mean, it doesn't have to go that far, but it still has. And yet, oh, that's absolutely the body. How the fuck big was this guy? Everyone's eating a piece of him. Millions of people. All of it. You know, I mean, that's crazy.
We've been eating him for 1500 years. Still hasn't spoiled.
Yeah. I love the meme that's been floating around. I've seen it a few different times, but it's making its way back around again. And it, you know. Scientists recently tested a Catholic communion wafer, and were surprised to find absolutely no DNA evidence of Christ within it. You know,
but
Catholics are shocked.
I thought it was mold.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
Well, no. I mean, Catholicism.
Oh,
is,
yeah. Oh,
know,
no. I was referring. Did you see the one where recently the preacher dropped a wafer into a thing of holy water? In the water, instead it turned red, like almost instantaneous, like it was the blood of Christ.
Oh, yeah, it was mold. Yeah.
It was mold. It's like, you know, you're making them eat moldy crackers.
Well,
that was the mold.
The holy water itself, but
you know,
full of fecal matter they've tested.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah.
You keep dunking those babies in it.
No. Anyway. Yeah, it's just so gross.
Fecal matter.
Yeah.
Anyway, did you have another question?
No, I mean, I was just.
Oh, because I wanted to ask you about earlier in the show. You mentioned that there were, you know, that you can look at different things and people can claim that they are religions, but you but you disagree that they are religions.
Yes.
And
because words are important, words matter.
Yeah. Well, and we've talked about activism and that kind of stuff. And I mean, looking around the studio, you can see we've got stuff from the Satanic Temple here. Yeah. And I'm a big fan of the work the Satanic Temple does. I was wondering what your views are on what the Satanic Temple does and how they're going about things. Because I've heard from other people that, you know, I respect a great deal and agree with on most everything, saying that they think the Satanic Temple is ultimately damaging to the cause of atheism and damaging to the separation of church and state, because it's just wrapping bullshit under a different type of label and promoting itself as a religion. And in my view, the Satanic Temple fills a particular niche perfectly, right? Because they label themselves as a religion and then therefore use all of the arguments and benefits and special privileges that all of these other religions have claimed for so long, when they're basically diametrically opposed or these other Christians and whatever other faiths view Satanists as being so terrible, but they're using the same arguments to present a separation of church and state and to promote a secular government and basically allowing really no religious privilege, but saying that they're doing so on a religious basis.
Yeah.
So.
I have a great admiration for Lucien Greaves and the Satanic Temple. I think they're doing good work. I think the people who say that they're doing bad work and that they're making atheists look bad don't realize that they're making atheists look bad to the ignorant masses who already hate atheists.
Exactly, right? My point when I hear that stuff.
They're not hurting us any more than we're already hurt, because they may be reinforcing a stereotype, but they're reinforcing a stereotype with the people who know us the least and already hate us. Yeah. What they are doing is taking the Church of the Flying Spaghetti Monster one step farther. and they're saying they're using an actual religious figure and actual religious texts and using it to further a secular government. It's brilliant. And it's really, really effective. And we worked with them at Oklahoma City to get the Ten Commandments removed. The ACLU went in on the federal level, the state level, we went in on the federal level, and the Church of Satan went in to try and get a 14th Amendment type of an equal statue. And the three of us worked together, and the monument went away. It's effective, and it made a change, and it made a positive change. And I think that, the way he's using it, the way the Satanic Temple is massaging themselves, they're not a religion, okay? But they are a religion legally. They're not a religion definitionally.
Sure.
But legally, just like the secular Jews, they are.
Mm-hmm.
And they're using that to their advantage. They're using it to our advantage.
Yeah.
And I think they're doing great work, and I support them.
So you say that they're not a religion definitionally. What would you consider – what is your definitional – What is your definition of a religion?
What makes it
a religion?
This is the thing. There were three definitions for religion. One is the belief in a God. A God, of course, is defined as a supernatural intelligence. Okay. One is the practice of ceremonies around a belief in a God. And one is something that's pursued fervently. Okay. So definition three is stupid. Okay.
I really like to golf. I think I could start.
Yeah, exactly. I know, right. You know,
definition three, something that's pursued fervently is ridiculous. Okay. Yeah. That's equating the Catholic Church with thumb twiddling or football.
Yeah.
Or turning on and off a light switch for an OCD person. That's not a religion. Okay.
Right.
So if you just summarily omit that stupid ass definition because it's stupid, because it's something that's so broad that's to be meaningless, then you've got the relief, or then you've got something, two definitions that require a supernatural belief, the belief or the practice surrounding the belief. So you've got, in order to have a religion, you have to have a belief in a supernatural deity, a supernatural intelligence. And that makes the Satanic Temple atheistic, a club. That makes the secular Jews a club, not a religion.
Well, and I'm curious about that, because I think Lucien would probably say that
he says he's a non-theistic religion.
Yeah,
that's how he defines himself.
Yeah, and to say that you have to have a belief, you know, that, that necessarily, or that a necessary part of a definitional religion is that you have to have belief in a supernatural deity. I think he would say that that's playing into a religious narrative just as the Christians would do.
I'm just taking the definitions out of the book, out of the dictionary. Okay. Words have meanings.
Yeah.
And I say the opposite. I say that he's playing into the religion by, and the secular Jews are playing into the religion narrative by claiming to be a religion. By claiming to be a religion, you're claiming to be theistic. You're mm-hmm. implying theism. Okay. You're implying a belief in a God. That's what the vernacular is. They're the ones playing into it by calling themselves a religion, by saying we want to be a religion because being a religion is good. That's playing into the narrative. Now, he and I disagree on this one point and, you know, he's wrong, but that's fine.
well, we've got him on next week. So I'll be
fine.
Asking him the same tips.
He's doing good work and he's using the law to do good work.
Yep.
And I have no problem with using the law to do good work. So, you know, I'll disagree with them on a thing.
Yeah. You know? It's a pretty minor point.
Yeah.
It's a real minor point. And you know, we're playing different roles here and we're doing different things. And the role that he's doing kind of requires him to take that position.
Sure does.
It absolutely requires him to take that position.
Yes, it does.
And it's an incorrect position, I maintain, but that's fine. He's doing the role. He's doing the job. He's getting stuff done.
Yeah. Well, so you're not very far apart. I think Dan's objection was the same that the concerns I had was certain people we were listening to in the movement who are actually fairly influential, just had absolutely 100% objection because it's just as false as the God thing. But, you know, whatever. I mean, the results are what they are.
If you're putting it on a scale, like, well, how can you say one is equal to another when you look at the results that they're getting? That was my
That
was my problem with a lot of the things that these other people that, you know, I respect and listen to quite a bit were saying and that I completely disagreed with. And so I'm glad for your take on that. Thank you very much.
Sure.
This was a point I thought was really interesting. You know, all theists are victims.
Yep.
For the most part. I mean, or liars, right? But theists, well, true theists are victims.
Yes. As is anybody who believes a lie.
Right.
Yep.
Right. But all the rest of us are also victims, as a point you made.
Yes.
Because we have fewer rights because of religion.
Yeah.
Yes.
And this is what led into your suit with the IRS and tax exemption preference.
Every single one of us pays more taxes because God.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Right. It doesn't matter if we believe in God or not. Because God, we pay more taxes. We pay more taxes than we deserve to pay. Every single one of us. Mm-hmm. That's wrong. Every single one of us has a shorter life expectancy and life expectancy and health expectancy. I'm losing the word.
Because
there was no stem
quality
cell research.
Of health.
Yeah. Quality of health. Quality of life.
Yes.
Expectancy. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because of the halt on stem cell research.
Oh,
because
right.
of religion.
Yeah.
Okay. Every single one of us, every person in the world is negatively affected because religion has such an influence on our lives.
And we've suffered because of the delay in that research.
Yes.
Yeah. We could have
and that's a real
cancers.
Thing. I mean, who knows if we're 6 years away from Alzheimer's disease cure, because that means how many people are going to suffer from Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease because George W. Bush said, God said no stem cell research.
Right.
It's that asinine.
Yeah.
And we're not angry and we're not mad. Why aren't we mad? Why aren't we rising up? We are dying.
Yeah.
We are paying extra money and dying earlier and suffering more because God says so.
Right.
Yeah.
That's bad.
Because their God says
because
so.
Because somebody says their God says
so. Right. Yeah, even better.
Okay, because remember, they all invent their own gods. So every God is fictional. So somebody said, I don't like it, and my God agrees. And somebody said, oh, your God thinks so. Well, then we should stop it. That's actually what happened.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so we all pay more money and have shorter life expectancies and have lower quality of life expectancies because that conversation actually happened.
Right.
That's wrong. And that's why we should fight. That's why it's our ethical responsibility to kill religion dead. It's for us. It's for them. And it's for everybody's children. It's for the entire world. Mm-hmm. Religion deserves to die.
But just think about the money we save,
right,
too. If churches and religious organizations stop getting their way and we have lawsuits being brought up against, like, oh, we're going to fight homosexuality. Oh, yeah, we're going to fight that stem cell research. Oh, we're going to fight this and fight this. And it's like, you're using taxpayer dollars to fight shit
That helps you.
That's going to help you, and it's going to be passed anyway.
Because you think your God wants you to.
Yeah.
Because your God agrees with exactly with what you think. Exactly. 100%.
Right. Like, how many times has Obamacare been fought? 60 some odd times, spending billions of dollars on that?
Well, that's one of my favorite pastimes, is getting people of professed same religious belief arguing against each other over particular points of doctrine.
Yeah.
There's a couple guys that I work with who are very LDS, and I like to get them arguing about, you know, specific tiny details of their religious belief or what they say, you know, all Mormons believe. And one day at work, one of the guys that I was talking to said that, you know, I had them get into an argument about whether the Holy Ghost can follow you into a strip club or not. Because one of them said that they know for a fact that the Holy Ghost does follow you into a strip club. And the other one said, and he said that he knows that the Holy Ghost does follow you into a strip club, because if the Holy Ghost hadn't followed him into a strip club and been whispering in his ear, he would have done some really, really inappropriate things while in the strip club. And the other one was arguing that no, the Holy Ghost does not follow you into a strip club. That's why you're not supposed to ever even go into a strip club. And then they got in this like 20 or 30 minute debate at work, and I was just like, well, this is lovely.
Exactly.
you guys don't know what the fuck you're talking about, and you're talking about nonsense, and I'm just sitting back in my chair giggling at how ridiculous this argument is between the two of them.
Yeah.
That's one of my favorite pastimes.
I love that. And that's why I love going on Fox News and getting the theists to argue among themselves. That's a great thing, you know. Oh, really? You think that? Well, this guy thinks the other thing. What do you think about that? You know, this guy thinks that God is this way. And I love doing that. It's so much fun. And the host gets all upset, and then they don't invite me on Fox News anymore.
Not a bad thing.
Well, I noticed
it is a bad thing. I liked Fox
News. Well, yeah. I mean, we liked seeing you on there, but
I think it was just a direct interview with you one time where one of them said, "Well, David Silverman, you're a Jew, so how could you be an atheist?" I was like, what? What did she just say?
It's amazing.
Well, again, it's
a level of ignorance that we have to get used to. And remember, a lot of the Fox News hosts, they're talking dumb. Mm-hmm. They're talking dumb to their plebeians, their flock.
So they're a lot better off air.
Yeah.
Some of them.
Yeah, some of them.
Which is kind of tragic, you know?
It is.
I mean, my mother watches Fox News. And has the worst ideas and arguments whenever I talk to her, in large part because of that, you know, and because they're intentionally dumbing themselves down for her and for the rest of it. It's frustrating.
It's awful, and it's wholly immoral.
Yes.
And it's wholly un-American, anti-American. And it's something that I wish we could topple, but I don't think we can until we topple religion first, because there's too much money there.
So recently I listened to your interview on, was it Chauncey?
Yeah, Chauncey. I just did Chauncey. Chauncey DeVega.
Thank you very much. Thanks for recommending that to Mel. But I listened to that, and one of the topics that you talked about a little bit was, being married to Hildy and somebody who is Jewish. And being married to an atheist. And you talked about the difference between, Judaism and Christianity or Islam, in that, you know, with Judaism, there's no thought of hell.
There's no soul saving.
Yeah. There's no soul saving. And so, you know, it's, I don't know that you exactly said it, but the gist that I got was that it's easier being married to somebody who's Jewish versus somebody who's Christian or Islamic, because the Christian or Muslim who you may be married to would feel it a moral imperative to try to change you or convert you to their religion.
Right.
Where a Jewish person may not.
Right. And, there's two reasons there. First of all, is the soul saving. There's no obligation. A Jew does not have a requirement, and there's no danger in it. A Jew thinks that when you die, whatever happens is between you and God. That's pretty much it. It's not a matter of if you don't have faith, you're going to hell. There's no New Testament. There's no Revelation. There's no Matthew. There's no damning. So if you don't have that, you don't have the worry. You don't have the worry. The other side of it is that according to Jews, according to theistic Jews, Jewish atheism is completely a thing. So as far as my wife was concerned, I was still a Jew, right? Because I was born to a Jewish mother. So that makes me a Jew.
Yeah,
and that's it. That's all I needed. I was bar mitzvahed. I was circumcised. I'm a Jew.
Yeah. Well, and I think that was part of the, that was part of the reasons that you started looking at, Jewish atheism and trying to say, you know, trying to prove that that is a thing before you gave your talk.
And that's what happened. And the super secret is that my wife is no longer a Jew. My wife is no longer a Jew. After 24 years of marriage, she read Fighting God and came out. She read Fighting God before it was published and came out an atheist.
What?
Came out to me as an atheist. Yeah.
What?
That's amazing.
I hadn't heard that at all.
And she had had doubts, and it, Fighting God didn't convert her, but it got her to admit it.
Well, did you just make news here? Because I haven't heard that on any of the other...
I haven't told too many people. We haven't made it real public, but yeah. She's an atheist.
Oh, wow.
And she's awesome. Out. Yeah.
Congratulations, man. That's
I don't take congratulations for it. I didn't try to convert her. I did it. You know, she did it herself.
No,
and
but
that's a good thing.
But a testament to the success of your book.
Yeah.
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 So congratulations on that.
Yeah. It's very gratifying to know that I've helped my wife away from the lie of God. Right.
Yeah.
And so now that it's done, I regret not doing it sooner. And so as I was writing Fighting God, and as she was, I was putting the finishing touches. There was a time when I was still writing it, still editing it, still putting on the finishing touches. And she had already come out to me because she had already edited the book. She had already looked at the book. And so I actually realized that I had done her wrong by not doing it. Mm. You know, there had been times when she had said,
come on. By not doing it sooner?
Yeah. Mm. By not aggressively proselytizing, for lack of a better word, atheism to her. I thought about all the money she spent on the shuls and the synagogues that she went to. I thought about the exposure that I put my daughter through to this religion that could have damaged her. I thought about all of the time that she wasted on this religion, and I realized that I had done her damage by living and let living. And that's where I realized that live and let live might not be the ethical choice. That was kind of a key thing. I actually regretted living and let living. Because, I mean, she had said to me, you know, let's have a discussion. Let's talk religion. Tell me why I should be an atheist. And I had said no. I had said, no, you get there yourself. And I thought all high and mighty about myself for doing that because I thought I was being the good guy. You know, I'm not going to convince you to go your way. I'm not going to push my way on you, blah, 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 blah. But I think it was
I'm not here to convert you.
Right.
I'm not. Yeah.
But I think that was the wrong decision.
Yeah.
I think the right decision would have been, yes, let's have the talk. Let me show you why you're wrong. And I should have done it 25 years ago.
Yeah.
Wow. So you said that she came out to you while she was editing, while she was helping you edit the book.
Yeah. Yeah. She basically read the book and she was helping me edit the book and, before the editors got to it. And, when she read it, she realized that coming out was important and saying it and admitting it was important. And she admitted it to herself and then she admitted it to me.
Was she able to point to any one particular thing within the book that really was like the argument that swayed her?
It was about the need to come out. It was about the need to come out and the need to not making the lie of God bigger and atheism look smaller. It was about the need to become an outed atheist.
Wow.
And, it really struck a chord with her and she came out.
Well, and so then I would have to say, you know, you say you don't want to accept congratulations on this. I would say congratulations to her for
indeed
living a more authentic life.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. She deserves it. She did the work.
That's awesome.
She did the work. Yeah.
That's awesome.
That is really
I'm very
cool.
happy to hear that.
Yeah, me too. And so was my child. we used to sit at a Passover table. It was the four of us. It was me, my wife, my daughter, and my father-in-law. My father-in-law is an atheist. My child's an atheist. I am an atheist. My wife was a Jew. And Rayanne would sit there and say, why are we doing this? We're atheists. There's three atheists at this table. There's no God. You know there's no God. You know there's no God. Why are we doing this? And my wife would just go through the motions and kind of giggle it off and laugh it off. And I was trying to be supportive of my wife. And I would gently scold my daughter, you know, we're here to support your mom, blah, 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 blah. And that was the wrong thing to do. My daughter was right. My child was right. Yeah.
I've never understood Passover. Why Jewish people think Passover is a good thing?
Oh, because it's all tribal. right?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's all good when they die and we live. When the outgroup dies, it's a good thing when the firstborn child of the bad guys die. They're the outgroup. Yeah. Sure, they're children. Sure, they're innocent, but they're the innocent people of the outgroup. They're bad.
Yeah, so they're in that sense, they're not innocent at all. Have you read the Old Testament? The entire thing is based on.
Well, I have, but it's one of those things that always stuck with me. Like, how is that a good thing? How is it a good thing that these people are being murdered, and then why do you have to mark their doors? Like, is God so stupid? Like, God tells you to go and mark their doors because he doesn't fucking know where they are? Like, are they hiding? Have they cast some magic spell over their house?
One thing you can say about Judaism is the Jewish God is really dumb. I mean, he's really dumb.
Yeah.
He's a dumb asshole tyrant.
Big
jealous.
Thug, though.
Yeah, he's a bad dude. He's a bad dude, and he's really dumb. He can be fooled really easily.
Well, yeah. Well, and I think that plays into Pascal's wager, where you assume that your God is so fucking dumb, he won't know
that you're faking.
That you're pretending to believe in him, right?
And that, I go into that in Fighting God as well. I talk about Silvermanity, remember?
Yeah.
So I talk up. So Pascal's wager says you should pick religion, because if you die and religion is right, you go to heaven, and if you die and religion is wrong, you just die. And if you pick atheism and you die and religion is right, you go to hell. So you pick you take the one without the least fear,
the least bad consequence.
The least bad consequence. So I invented a new religion called Silvermanity, which I just invented off the top of my head. Although I will give credit to my wife, who came up with the word Silvermanity, because I think I was Davism at first, but she changed it to Silvermanity, which is funnier. And said that if you don't believe in Silvermanity, you will go to hell, and all of your ancestors will be pulled from heaven, and they will go to hell.
Right.
So and all of your descendants will go to hell. So that's worse. And you'll know it.
It's
much worse. So you better use Pascal's wager and send me all your money.
Yep.
And it's the same logic. It's the same logic.
Absolutely.
Oh, by the way, if you do believe in Silvermanity, you will go to super awesome heaven, which is much better than regular old heaven, because not only do you go to super awesome heaven, but all of your ancestors, they go to super awesome heaven, and they know you got them there.
Yep.
So everybody loves you, and everybody's in super awesome heaven forever. And that's better than regular heaven, because in regular heaven, you still have your grandmother might be in hell, and that's bad. That's not perfect.
Right.
That's imperfect.
Right.
Super awesome heaven with Silvermanity. Everybody goes to heaven if you give me all your money.
Yeah.
So where do I mail the check?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm thinking, perfect. I mean, where's my wallet?
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. That was great. I had a question. I wanted to kind of close on this one.
Sure.
In the book, you mentioned that American atheists are the Marines of the movement.
Mm-hmm.
I don't doubt that or deny that. But some segments are poorly represented, as you mentioned in the book as well. Dan and Tracy were able to cultivate a group that more than doubled in size during their tenure, in AOU. And I'm just curious, for people who are out there listening in areas that might be poorly represented, what are some things that lead to successful growth in atheist groups for both of you?
What leads to successful growth? I think particularly here in Utah, where you have one really, really dominating religion, leaving that faith behind, you don't just leave behind a belief in supernatural bullshit. You leave behind your social structure. You know, a lot of the time you're ostracized by both your family and friends. You lose every bit of your community. You lose everything outside of yourself, because the LDS Church has insinuated itself into your life to such an extent, right? So when you leave the LDS faith here in Utah, you leave behind everything apart from your self-identity. And so in order to help those people and grow the atheist community here in Utah, one of the biggest things is to let them know that it's, you know, the atheist community here in Utah isn't just about disbelief in God. It's about building community and providing that social structure that they've left behind or have been abandoned by or ostracized from when they leave their organized religion, and that they have a place to land and a community of people who can support them and provide a lot of the same social structure and events and volunteer opportunities and gatherings and a place to be social with other people outside of the religion that they've left behind, and that they don't have to pretend to have a belief in some invisible sky wizard in order to have those experiences and be social with other human beings.
Mm-hmm. So from my perspective, I think, there are two big things that leads to a successful atheist group. The first thing is to accept diversity. And it's not about cultural diversity. Yeah. It's about diversity of thought within the atheist movement. Mm-hmm. I, for example, would never set foot in an atheist church. Okay. I mean, yeah. I might go speak at an atheist church, mm-hmm. but the whole concept of getting up on a Sunday morning and going and listening to some guy with a guitar sing Kumbaya and hugging people.
That just sounds tiring.
But the
I'd
thing
much
is,
I'd rather roll out of bed and have some coffee.
But the thing is, you still have to accept that. You still have to support it. People like That's it. True. Even if I don't like it, even if I might find it repugnant, other atheists like it and other atheists find it important. And that is important for me to accept. Mm. The other thing that I've noticed is very effective, and I saw this when I did the Reason Rally, and I have to mention the Reason Rally.
Yes.
Is that a lot of times people talk about leading atheists as herding cats. They use that metaphor, mm-hmm. that you're trying to herd cats when you lead atheists. Mm-hmm. I don't do that. I just lead. I don't herd. I lead, mm-hmm. right? So when I put together the Reason Rally, I just put together the Reason Rally. I said, hey, everybody, I'm doing this over here. Y'all can come if you want to. And everybody came. Some didn't, but most people came. Now, if I said, hey, everybody, we're all doing this Reason Rally. Come, we're doing this Reason Rally. You're in and you're in and you're in and you're in and we're all in. We're doing a Reason Rally. They would have been more, I think there would have been more resistance to it. And I think that's because atheists are, we have kind of a knee-jerk reaction against hurting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We do.
Yeah. And it's an instant repellent almost to say that I'm, you know, that we should all do this versus, I'm doing this. Hey, if you want to come over, great. Yeah.
It's a big difference. Yeah. It's a big difference. And that's why the Reason Rally, the first Reason Rally was so successful. So I think those are the two key components. And I'm going to use that as a segue to the Reason Rally, mm-hmm. which by the way is, happening again. So we had the first Reason Rally, which was in 2012, and we had 30,000 atheists of all stripes. And when I say atheists, I'm talking about anybody who doesn't believe in God, mm-hmm. whatever the name is. We had 30,000 atheists at the shore of, at the Mall of Washington, D.C., and we're doing it again. We had a fantastic time. It was a sublime time. It was an impactful thing. This year, June 4th, we're having Reason Rally 2. Reason Rally 2. Now, I'm not running it, but I am running the programming. Okay. And I know who's coming. And you guys don't know who's coming. But I know who's coming. And you want to be there. We have a bigger budget. We have a bigger name, lots mm-hmm. of bigger names. And it's going to be a bigger event. It's going to be an entire weekend long. There's going to be a mini convention after it. There's going to be comedy. There's going to be live music. And there's going to be some fantastic speakers, A-level speakers. At this event. So, if you can, I mean, American Atheist is not having a national convention. Dan's wearing our convention shirt from 2014.
Yay!
There will not be a 2016 national convention of American Atheists because all eyes to the Reason Rally. Everybody needs to come. This is going to be the biggest atheist event in world history. Everybody needs to come. And oh boy, I wish I could tell you who's coming. Oh boy.
Tracy and I have already booked our rooms. We're just, we've got a little alert out for airfare, but yeah, we will be there for
Thanks. Thanks. And by the way, American Atheists is America's oldest nonprofit organization for atheists. Mm-hmm. The website is atheists.org. And by the way, if you're not a member of American Atheists, or Atheists of Utah, it is time to fucking join.
Yes.
Okay. and I don't need to speak to everybody out there who's listening, who's not an active dues fucking paying member of a national organization and a local organization, because we're changing the country. The locals and the nationals are changing the country. And when it comes to American Atheists, I can prove it. And when it comes to Salt Lake City, Dan can show it.
Yep.
We are changing this country, and the shit ain't free, folks. We have bills to pay. And if you're just riding the coattails, you need to stop. You need to pony up the $35 for a yearly membership for American Atheists. It's $35. Might I mention that I can show quantitative data which shows a direct impact on a national level to American Atheist activity, a direct impact on a quantitative level. I can show you numbers, and I do it in Fighting God, that shows you that we are definitely improving this country for you. $35, folks. $35, www.atheists.org. Thank you for your support.
Woo!
Yes. Thank you. Absolutely. I get so many people
love it
because they're not required to donate to get the benefit. They don't donate. And that's shit. That's crap. We're working our asses off here.
Yeah.
American Atheist has, count them, 5 employees. 5 employees. We are changing the country with five employees.
Wow. I figured it was more than that.
Yeah, well, we got a lot of volunteers.
Okay.
But we've got 5 employees.
Yeah.
And guess what? We have quantitatively shown that we can change the country and have changed the country measurably. $35.
That's amazing.
Okay? Atheists.org.
Why didn't Nick Fish give us this when he was That was amazing.
So if they go to atheist.org, can they also see where you're going the rest of your book tour?
They can. They can go to atheists.org/fightinggod.
Okay.
And they can see where the book tour is coming. I've got an event tomorrow here in Salt Lake City.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I've also got one coming up in Nashville. I've got 2 coming up in New Jersey. I've got Philadelphia coming up, and more being scheduled every day. Austin is being scheduled right now.
All right.
So go to atheists.org/fightinggod and pick up Fighting God. It's a pretty good book. I kind of like it.
Absolutely. Buy Fighting
God.
I really enjoy
it.
It's worth having in your library. I was telling Dave before the show, the book that I have previously had marked up the most was Atheist Universe by David Mills. And I've read a lot of books since then. None of them, I haven't marked any of them up. I think this one, I'll have to go do an official count, but I think Fighting God was the book I highlighted and marked more, that's finally surpassed Atheist Universe. It's a great book. Go get it. Fighting God by David Silverman. Absolutely amazing.
Thank you.
And it's been a pleasure to have you on the show.
Yeah. Been a pleasure to be here.
Matt sent me several messages as he started reading the book, like, oh my God, dude, this book is so fucking good. Like,
did you get
to
chapter
4
yet?
Notes. I don't even know where to fucking begin. Like, I'm going to have so many questions and so many things I want to talk about that at this point I'm like, why am I even bothering just marking this shit up? We'll just talk about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's been very, very excited about the book, as have I. I think it's awesome. It's a great bit of work, David. I really appreciate you doing it.
Thank you, Dave. Yeah.
I also really, really appreciate you coming out here for the show tonight.
Absolutely.
This has been a great time.
Yeah, it's a fun time.
Love seeing you, man. 2 hours went fast.
It does.
So the event tomorrow is at the Salt Lake City Public Library. We will have you actually start speaking around 6:30. The event is set to kick off right about 6 o'clock. You know, people can show up, purchase some books, get them signed, or actually just purchase the books, wait to get them signed until after you speak.
Mm-hmm.
But then, David will be speaking. We'll have a Q&A session afterward. I'm really looking forward to it. I'm expecting more than 100 people to show up.
Excellent. So,
I'll be shoving a camera in your face.
Rock and roll.
Should be a great
time. I'll make sure to comb my hair.
Yeah, Ryan will be gathering video and audio for us. Also, tomorrow morning, David will be on Radio From Hell on X96 with Carrie, Bill, and Gina. That should be a whole lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to give you the skinny on what I expect will happen there.
Okay, tomorrow. That sounds like fun.
Yeah, they're awfully nice.
Yeah, they're a great bunch of people. That should be a whole lot of fun. Once again, thank you very much for tuning in, everybody. You can find us at at godlessrevolution.podbean.com. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/godlessrevolution. You can Twitter our twatter at TGR Podcast. Send us a text message or leave us a voicemail at 33081REBEL. And once again, thank you so much for coming on, Dave. This was a great time.
Thanks for having me on, Dan. It's great to see you again.
Hey, you too, my friend. Yeah. All right. Thanks for tuning in. Never.
Never. Made it all the way to the end.
God. Then I had to fuck it up. Bye.
When I wake up in the morning, love, sunlight hurts my eyes. And something without wanna love bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's alright with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Instead of me, always seems to know the way. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. Then I look at you, and the world's all